We will move to another film Before the Collapse of Mont Blanc by Jacques Perconte, who is here with us from Paris, France. So welcome, Jacques.
Hello.
And I'm really happy that that we again screened your film. We have screened many of your films in the past, and for me personally, it's quite amazing to observe your creative journey. So how you experiment with the ways, how what are the like endless possibilities, how you can disrupt the digital image and create a completely new set of of visual attractions, thanks to specific procedures that you developed for your works. But what I very much appreciated about this film was also its topic. So I will also ask you about the procedure, but first let's discuss the topic, because you are pointing the attention to the climate crisis and to the phenomenon of how the mountains are in a way becoming smaller, because part of the rocks are being erosed and they are falling down. So we really don't know if the peak of the Mont Blanc, which is one of the iconic images for our generations, if it will last in fact. And this is, if I understand it well, this is something you wanted to capture in your film. Am I right? And what was your motivation? Why did this phenomenon so much intrigued you?
thank you for all your comments, Andrea. The thing, like all of my film, it starts with a shooting, and I'm shooting in the Alps, not especially the Mont Blanc, more in the south of the Alps, les écrins with La Meije, but that is one of my favorite mountains in the Alps. And actually, when you film there, you just cannot ignore the falling of the cliffs. And every summer, there is a lot of cliffs that start to go off. And it's very impressive. And every time you try to search for information, you find some mountain guides who explain how the mountain is changing, and with the climate change. I was very impressed by this thing, but factually, by the fact that it became very dangerous to go walking in certain part of the mountain. And in the summer, there is some tracks that are closed for the walkers, because it's very too much dangerous to go there. And it's a several kind of crossing of topics inside the film, because the Mont Blanc has become a touristic place, and it is iconic, but iconic as a touristic place because it's kind of the highest mountain in Central Europe, but also it's the people believe it's easy to go there. So it's like a lot of people go there to walk and to make image and to experience this very high altitude. But the fact is that there is also a double movement, that it's going higher and higher all the time, because there is still a strong pressure with the tectonic, and the plates are moving and the mountains are rising. So it's a double movement. The climate change makes it fall, but also it's growing up at the same time. And so it's about the disappearing of the iconic image of the Mont Blanc. So this shape that we know and that some people even wanted to register as a heritage of, for the humanity, like something you cannot touch, it might not stay there with this shape.
That's really... this is a very nice point, because in fact, especially through the climate changes, we are touching and changing it very much. So
completely, yeah.
So we can wish that it can be part of the cultural heritage, but with our other actions that we do and influence the climate, we are in fact changing it. This is also interesting, your film, thematic wise, just because what you said, because I think that really many people are observing falling of the rocks, especially when they are hiking or they are going to the mountains, but I think it's not so well known that that one of the reasons is also the climate change, and so this is one of the consequences. So it's also it's very very good that we can also find out this through your film. So so let's now speak about how the film was made. I mean, I so much. I so much enjoy watching the film that contains like the documentary images. Yeah, we see the mountain, we see the cliff, and then to emphasize this motif of falling apart, also the images start to fall apart like completely, and in the end we have several sequences when the images are almost completely abstract. They are only made of these geometrical patterns that were derived from the original images. So you really embodied this motif of destruction into images as well. So could you please elaborate on how did you make the film, and what was your procedure also from the technical point of view, how you achieved these really beautiful images?
As I told you, the film was started in my mind with a shooting, and it was last year. I was shooting in the Alps, and I had this bit stupid idea to film the Mont Blanc from a plane. And so, and I found a plane, and they took me to 4,000 meters with my camera, but without oxygen, and with the winds of the Mont Blanc, and because the shape of the mountain is very shaky, so it was a bit crazy shooting. And when I seen my image, I was very surprised by what I filmed, actually, because I didn't know what was happening when I was in the plane. And I really liked it, and I wanted to build a film around it. And but I didn't want to touch this image, almost not to touch them, because it's like my main documentation, my experience of seeing the Mont Blanc from a special place. And that is difficult to reach. Even you can book a tour, a flying tour around the Mont Blanc. But then I wanted, and I think it's maybe the first time that I really wanted to build something around it with some image I didn't shoot. And so I started to look at all the films about mountains and about avalanche that I could find online, on television, everything. I really documented a lot of myself because I had, I think, kind of certain type of image I wanted to find. And so I collected them from a lot of different films to have this corpus of avalanche at the beginning of the film. And then I started to work them and I refilmed them on screens. So all of the image, I filmed them with a camera from a computer screen to have a bit more something inside the image. And then after for adding some details in the colors with the compression work as I do normally. And then also I told myself that this film might be the moment where I can really use this funny tool that helps you to visualize the motion vectors in the video compression that you can find in a lot of tools like FFmpeg, for example, that is the main tool used for video compression. It's a way to visualize the infrastructure of the image to understand how it works. And with this falling apart and these avalanches, I told myself that you will visualize more than the motion vectors, but the dynamic of the avalanche in the image itself. And so it was a double game to put a parallel between the collapsing of the subject and the collapsing of the image itself. And then I just kept this arrows. In fact, it's a very tiny arrows that are everywhere in the image. And they describe the tension and the movement inside the image itself. So I used it already once in Ettrick, my Scottish film, but no one seen it. It's like in the mills at one point, I just added this overlay, these arrows on the image in the mills, but it's quite discreet because it doesn't become the main subject as it became in this film, where you have like a very free sequence of the film that are dedicated to the infrastructure of the image.
Oh, that's very interesting. And you are right that in Ettrick, which is one of the films that we screened in the past, it was in Opus Bonum section, I think.
Yeah.
That I don't recall this kind of image there. So probably this procedure was really used in a very subtle way in that case.
Yeah. It's very discreet. It's in the mills and we have the machines moving to wave the sockets, the socks, and then it's on overlay on the machine movement. But it's funny because I put that and no one mentioned it ever. And then, so it's like, but it's quite a standard way to visualize the things. It's really not difficult to do. The question was how to use it and to find a way in one of my film a day where it's almost needed to use it.
Yes, but I think that it's completely all right, or it's fantastic to use the tools that are common to for work with images, what you do is exploring the possibilities, how far it can go, what is the variability of the manipulations it is able to do to the original image. And also what I consider really key, a very, very important thing is that you use these tools to, as you described it, to say the motif that you want to say in the content, to say it also in this form or in this technical procedure. So it really corresponds in the message. Yes, so that's that is really very important, I think, and it works really beautifully in this film, that it's also comprehensible for the viewer, and also the images are that it's really aesthetic pleasure to to watch.
I become head.
No, it's really great. So maybe I will again ask our attendees if maybe somebody wants to ask a question or say a remark, and I will check the chat. Okay, there are no questions. So I will ask you the last question. How did you think about the sound? Obviously, we also had to discuss the sound, because it's also important part of this whole experience with the film. So how did you think about it?
I think about started to make the music again of my films. I used to do it in the past, and I started again last year, something like that, the four last film I made the music, and I feel like it's the energy I want to pulse into the image. So it's I was looking at the film and then closing at the film and just trying to put energy and to develop something, and then after I was putting the sound on the film and editing it.
So the procedure was that you had the concept for the images first, and you created.
I made the film silent. Yes.
And then you composed the music to accompany this.
The film was silent. I also collected some sounds, and I have this recording of the cows that is at the beginning, the bells.
And
then I wanted to have this also that when the avalanche arrived, that it's a silence. So I wanted to make a lot of jumps at the beginning, so you don't know where the film will go, and lot of collapsing and rebuildings after each other, like the data that comes at the beginning with the title. Mm-hmm. It was a lot of ideas like that. But the music is really, when I make the music, I have the film in my mind. It's the almost the same part of my head, but they are neighbors. So they see each other sometimes, but not too often. And so it's quite autonomous process. I have the memory of what I've seen, then I work on the music only for maybe a few days, and then I go back to the film.
I like that that the music was not like illustrative to the emotion what should be derived from the images, but the music was in certain parts completely autonomous, but we have this complex audiovisual experience watching the film.
It's like to create a dispositive for the experience, not to illustrate the image, but to build the space for the viewer, as the frame, the work around the image with the colors and the shape of the image is also part of the dispositive, like the music.
Thank you very much, Jacques.
Thank you.
Thank you for talking with us about your film Collapse, Before the Collapse of Mont Blanc.
Yeah.
So greetings to France.